the road, my friend. Too long between rides. Too long between homes again. Too long without someone by my side. And Lord, there's something about a sad song. Helps to ease the pain. Here I am, Lord, just singing up a storm, and I'm all alone again. Too much going down today. Just can't take it in. Much running round today. Tell you where I've been. It seems that just like singing is the only thing you do. Helps me pass the time. Songs are just like ladies, can't forget them when you're through. They're always on. And the rosewood bitters help me meet the sunshine in the morning. And the rosewood bitters help me through the night when I feel blue. That's how it goes. So sure that there's more than this. No one really knows. And easing into midnight as the bitters pass around. I'm crying in my beer. Songs are just like singing someone else's trouble helps ease my own. Good night, Irene, my dear. And the rosewood bitters help me greet the sunshine in the morning. And the rosewood bitters help me through the night when I feel.
Great song, man.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Level Up Cleveland. Today we have in-house with us Mr. Drew Losch. If you're familiar with the name Drew Losch, it's possibly because a few episodes back on season one, Tyrone Hornbuckle brought up Drew Losch. He is a cinematographer, basically, right? I mean, sure. That's what you do. Yeah. He was the one who put together the Northeast Ohio Rock and Roll Retrospective documentary, basically, which features a lot of the artists from the 60s and 70s here in Cleveland. He actually was one of the main guys who's gone through and documented all this and talked to these guys since them times and gotten all the stories and been a part of some of the stories. And I find as we're doing this, a lot of the artists from that time that we talked to, they all know him. And he's well respected. So I just want to say, Drew, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me.
Heck yeah.
Great.
So how you doing? How's things going now for you?
I'm doing great. I'm fully retired.
Awesome.
And I'm still doing video here and there. You know, it's my passion. It's been my passion for a lot of years. And yeah, I'm looking to head to the PA Mountains here pretty soon.
Moving?
Yeah, just to get a change of pace, you know.
Nice.
Just a change of pace.
Is it off the grid type mountain thing?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah,
you're going all in, huh? Like that's kind of neat. So, are you going to be like filming nature or stuff while you're out there?
No, I just take a break and just do something peaceful, I guess.
That's awesome.
Because music can get kind of noisy, and my biz is noisy.
Yeah. So how do you get into, like you said, it's your passion? Like when did you first start wanting to do the filming part, and then later on, how do you get involved into this whole project?
Well, I saw a commercial on television for the Ohio School of Broadcast Technique.
Oh, yeah.
It's a different name now, and it's in Independence. I think it's the Ohio Center for Broadcasting or something like that. But this is when it was next to Channel 8 on Marginal Road
next,
in 90.
Next to the 90.
It was right smack next to Channel 8. And, I went to school for a year there, full time on the GI Bill. I'm retired military.
Oh,
and
thank you.
Oh, I'd do it all again. Really, I miss the military community a lot. Yeah,
do you stay in touch with them too?
Oh yeah,
the guys.
A lot of friends still. Oh, absolutely. You know, but yeah, I'd go back in a minute. But Uncle Sam wouldn't let me. I'm a little older now. Yeah, so I saw a commercial on television. I said, I'd like to do that, lights, camera, action, you could be behind the scenes and, the whole razzle-dazzle thing. So I went for it.
So you go, you get into it, and then, let me ask you this. So is it one of them situations where you had a passion for it, you get into it, and then you all of a sudden, bang, you're like, wow,
yeah.
I really love this. And then you almost like that addiction thing, or you can't get enough of it.
Absolutely.
Is that what happened?
I didn't want to leave the school. I said, wow, this is just so great. But of course, they give you your degree, your paper, and you're out the door. And then I said, okay, now what? And back in those days, the Cleveland television market, for getting into television, was just all sewn up. It was really, really tight.
Oh.
And for example, Channel 8 wanted you to intern for 6 months.
Oh.
For nothing.
For free.
And I had a house. I had a child. I couldn't do that. I had to get out and do things. So I saw an ad in a newspaper about videotaping weddings. And I thought, okay, so Joel Nash from North Coast Video, he tried me out. He put a camera in my hands, and he tried me out. He says, okay, you're hired. So I started doing weddings. And believe it or not, that really sharpened my skills because, when you're out there and you're capturing somebody's day, you miss one thing. You can't say, hold on, take two on that. If you don't get the shot, that's it.
Plus, I'd imagine the critic part of it where these people, the new wife wants everything to be just so. So you really got to be on your best for a lot of that kind of thing.
Documenting their day. And if you miss something, so you've really got to pay attention. Plus, again, it really sharpened my camera skills and movement and shot composition and all that. So that was basically my boot camp for my cinematography work. after so many years of, you know, doing personal videos and chasing a bride and groom around Northeast Ohio, you know, and being in every church in Northeast Ohio at least twice, I thought, you know what, it's getting kind of old, you know. I mean, it was great. You meet a lot of people, you know, and make new friends. But I wanted to do something else. And I lived really close to a bar on the west side. It was called Tam O'Shanter's. And a guy named Jim Stamper. Hi, Jim. We were having a beer, and he has this annual jam, Jam at the Tam, it's called. And they have a lot of the really upper class musicians come and play.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I told him I do video, and he says, really? You know, would you like to come in and capture this? I said, sure. So guys like Rich Spina came in there.
Wow.
Billy Sullivan, Paul Sidoti, who's with Taylor Swift now. You know, back in those days, they weren't. And so I set up two cameras in there, and I captured this night, and it came out so good, so good. As a matter of fact, there's a video of Rich Spina on my YouTube page. Punch it up on my YouTube and go down. No male artists that I know of ever sang Janis Joplin song.
I just watched this. I think I told you about it.
That was the night that I first did music video.
Yeah, I just watched this.
And from that night on, I was just, well, I'm going to go over here and do this, you know.
It was amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's so, Janis Joplin. And
mind-blowing.
It really is.
Rich. And, you know, all these guys that they had there that night, it was just, wow.
Yeah, that looked like an amazing jam.
I didn't know who they were because I spent a lot of time in the military, you know, and I missed a lot of groups like Love Affair, you know, and what was going on here. I'd come home on leave and, you know, I'd see a show. Well, I got to get back on a plane, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, I did a year in Korea and I did 2 years in Europe and traveled all over the States. So I was really busy, you know. And I missed a lot. So
you were into the rock scene, though.
Absolutely.
I mean, you and sure. Did you know any of them guys before
no,
any of this? So this
none.
This got you in touch with all these guys.
That night really sparked my interest in doing music video.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Excellent.
That was the night.
And that was also the night that they all found out about Drew. Because now they're like, before that,
yeah,
was there anybody really documenting a lot of this type of stuff for them?
Not that I know of.
Because it
no,
changes the game, right? I mean,
it
like
does.
If you're an artist, and all of a sudden somebody's documenting your stuff and you can watch yourself, it gives a whole different perspective on the whole entire thing you're doing.
Absolutely.
So now they know Drew, right? I mean,
yeah,
like, so this, and so at this point now in time, is that like the part where you totally go ballistic into this thing now? Because not only are you doing what you love in this thing, but you're meeting all these interesting people now, and it's kind of opening up different worlds of different things for you, right? Am I right? Yes,
absolutely. You know, and once it took me probably a week to edit it, you know, together. It was an A-B roll. There was two cameras that I had to mix together. And Jeff Scarborough did the sound that night, and the sound was just amazing. You know, it's not just camera sound. We plugged into the board and recorded that on tape, too.
Oh.
So I had to mix that also. And the whole thing was mind-blowing. And it was another four-hour gig, you know, almost like this. It was all night. So it came out so well. I said, man, I really want to do more of this. And once the videos started getting out, you know, people started looking, whoa, look at this. Oh, look at that, you know. So doors started opening a little bit there for me.
Well, so here's what I don't understand, though. So you have all this, you have all this stuff, and you, and this right here, I've seen a, quite a bit of it. I obviously not, because you just told me it's over 3 hours. So I, but I've seen bits and parts. Why isn't this so, like, totally available to everybody? Like, why isn't this something that you can literally just go get? I mean, I wouldn't think something like this, especially in Cleveland, which where people in Cleveland are just, they live and die the whole Cleveland thing. Yeah, why isn't this more available? Why
I would, copyright.
Really?
Copyright, yeah. I wanted to make this film with the original music from the records. And trying to get permission and authorization to use that is a nightmare.
Is it still? I mean, is it owned by the record companies still? Is that what you're dealing with, a lot of it?
Well, you have the label and the publishers. Oh. And back in those days, a lot of the artists that made these songs, they don't own them.
Yeah, they gave all the rights away to the record companies.
Yeah. Case in point, I went down to Houston, Texas to interview Adam Blessing and his brother, and I stayed with them for a while. We had a great time, and we're sitting at the table having dinner. I said, hey, guys, you know, I got to ask you, who owns your music? And they said, we don't know.
Oh, man.
And I said, what? They said, we were young. All we wanted to do was make records and play rock and roll, and they said, sign here.
Yeah, and they and there was a little chunk of money attached to it, and that's what they saw, and that they thought they made it.
Yeah, that was it. So that happened to a lot of artists.
A lot.
You know, sign here, and you know, the music doesn't belong to them, even though they wrote it, they produced it, you know, perform the whole nine yards. Sign here, and it's gone. I had to do everything for that film. I had to do the shooting, the producing, the directing, the editing. When I first started getting rolling on it, Jim Quint from Damnation of Adam Blessing, he did all of the phone calls, you know, and
I'll set everything
and
up
and set up all the interviews and stuff, you know. So I hired him to do it, to do that. But like everything else, as far as the music goes, again, you know, I wanted to put the original songs on this, but when I contacted the label or the records people, they never got back to me. I never heard anything from them.
Oh,
nothing. For instance, here's another one, too. That song, It's Cold Outside, by The Choir. That was a huge regional hit here. Huge. I think it might have went nationwide, too. But that was a big song for them. If you go on the internet and you look up It's Cold Outside, there's a million songs with that
title
name. But on the very top, they have the composer, who's Dan Klewan. And then it has... when, you know, it has dates and
sorry.
Once you get over to the far right, it says publisher and label. None. Where do I go from there? You know? And I talked to a couple guys in the choir too, and I told them, you know, what I just told you. They says, oh, I didn't know that. Look it up.
It was never, so no one's ever taken on the publishing rights.
I have no idea. No idea. So that was a brick wall.
Yeah. Okay?
But the way that I got around it was Wally Bryson, of course, was in the choir, and I captured one of his shows at the Masonic Auditorium. And guess who's playing bass? Dan Klewan. So I captured that show for Wally and Kay, and they did the song. They did a slow version, and they did a faster version. Oh. So that's the only way that I could legally put that song on that disc. Because when you're taking copyrighted music and you're putting it into a motion picture, okay, you have to have a synchronization license. It's totally different from an artist doing another artist's song.
Oh.
Totally different picture. And getting the synchronization license to put copyrighted music in a motion picture is a nightmare. And that's what, you know, the brick wall I hit. Well, we interviewed a total of 43 guys.
Really?
Yeah.
They all make the cut?
Oh, yeah.
Every one of them, huh?
And the average interview is about an hour. So, you know, that's a lot of footage. I have terabytes and terabytes just full of raw interview footage. And, of course, there's no way I could fit it into a disc, you know.
Yeah.
I really wanted this to be under 2 hours, but it was just impossible. Now it's 3 hours and 42 minutes between the two discs, you know.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was a great experience sitting down with these guys. And my sister did most of the interviewing.
Oh.
Okay. And there were two other gals, Vicky Hill and Leslie Lloyd and Gail Music. When my sister couldn't
be there,
you know, they were stand-ins. So they helped me with the interviews, and I did all the shooting, the sound, editing and all that stuff. But what a great experience sitting down. And the good thing about this is there's no narrator. There's no stand-up host, you know, saying, well, back in 1968, you know, the Raspberries or, you know, James Gang did this and that, and here's such and such. You know what I mean?
Yes.
I cut all of that out.
Yeah, I saw the very first thing I saw, it comes on, and Colin DeSalt is immediately in your, and he's talking right. Immediately. And
right.
It's like, you're already engaged.
Yep. Yeah. So what I wanted it to be was, you know, like you go out and you buy a record, something tangible in your hands, you know, that you can hold, something you can look at, you know. Because a lot of people said, well, you could put this on Spotify or such. No, I wanted to have something in your hands. So that's why I made this. I designed the cover. It's got all the guys going all the way around.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Glenn Schwartz. Initially, when I came home with all this footage, I had interviews with maybe 10 guys. And I'm putting them on the timeline. And all it was just them talking. I said, this needs more. It needs more. And that's where the music comes in. You know, so I tried to get the music a dead end there. You know, they probably thought, well, who's this Drew guy from Cleveland, Small Fry? I'm not 20th Century Fox with a lot of money. You know?
Right. That's the problem.
You know, but there were some artists that gave me their music, and they said, well, you have a limit of 1,000 copies. You know what I mean? So there's things like that I had to deal with, you know. So
wow.
That's why there hasn't been a big commercial release on that, because I'm limited because of that, you know.
Let me ask you this. What I do notice is, like, sometimes it seems like to circumvent the whole copyright thing and publishing thing, that they'll use live versions of the songs
right.
in order to get through that.
Right.
Could you do something like that with this? Like, if you could go and like get Herman's Hermits and get Sullivan playing.
Absolutely.
And you could use the live versions.
Yeah.
So that does circumvent that whole entire copyright thing.
As a matter of fact, I was talking to Jim Bonfanti from the Raspberries. He's the drummer. And I told him, and he said, well, the only way to, you know, you can use Raspberry songs. Eric and I will go in the studio and record. I said, you guys don't have to do that just for me. I said, no, that's all right. So yeah, you're right.
They could actually just re-record the version in a studio, and that changes. It's a new copyright.
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly. So, you know, but I wouldn't expect them to do
that. I would love to see this.
There's a lot of information in there. A lot. And you know what, too? What's really genuine about this, and you know, to further my point, was you have the guys talking straight to you on the screen, telling their stories. It's not like, well, you know, you read an article and you go, all right, well, somebody else wrote that.
Right.
And there's editors and there's all this stuff. None of that's
right from their mouths.
Right. You know, the stories. And the stories are amazing.
Yeah.
Joe Vitale, oh my God. He talked. I rolled the camera for an hour and 20 minutes for him, because he just had all this stuff to say. And I just keep it rolling.
100%.
Keep it rolling and capture it. Jimmy Fox from the James Gang, Dale Peters. We have Glenn Schwartz, too.
Yeah.
We were so lucky to have him, because it was about a year later he passed away.
Right. Yeah, that wagon wheel. Maybe you're on the long enough.
That you
I was 11 years old.
Wow.
Oh, I took lessons. My dad brought me to art school when I was 10 years old. I went to art school. I was always drawing and doing artwork. And then he called me. He played guitar players for me. And then he got me guitar lessons.
This is Mr. Glenn Schwartz.
Thank you.
I want to say a few words about Glenn. Back in the 50s, when the rock and roll first started, he was right there at the beginning. He was playing in Cleveland, and he was a wonderful guitar student, and he played with all different kinds of music. He played all through the rock and roll scene, all through the 50s and the early 60s. He went to the Army, and either was it Germany or something?
Germany.
He went to Germany. And he got to meet all these famous guitar players and stuff, and he went to see the clubs, and he played out there a lot too. And when the guitar playing sound of the guitar changed from the clean Les Paul sound of Mary Ford and all the nice, beautiful Chuck Berry, and we got into that raunchy sound, we didn't know how to do it. So what happened was Glenn came back, and he showed everybody how it was done. Because all we had as little kids was records. And those records, not like today with YouTube and all these young kids that are 12 years old and sound like Stevie Ray Vaughan. Okay? We were 12 years old and we couldn't figure out what these guys were doing. Well, how'd they get that sound? What was that raunchy, gutsy thing, that gutsy? Where do you get that sound from? So all of a sudden, he came back from the Army and he joined the original band called the James Gang.
Yeah, I used to order record rendezvous, and I'd go to Giant Tigers where they had the records for 19 cents each, used records. And I would get people like John Lee Hooker and Layton Hopkins, all the old black people from the cornfields. Songs like She's Almost Dead, No Food on My Table, No Shoes on My Feet. Yeah.
And we have Hank LaConte in there, who was the founder of the Agoras. And, of course, Michael passed away, too. And luckily, I spent 5 years on this. I can't wait anymore. I'm going to do the best I can with the music, and everything else. Yeah. And luckily, I sent Michael his copy. I sent it to him at WNCX about 4 months before he passed. And, if he didn't have it, I would have really, really felt bad. And Glenn, too. We didn't expect him to. Just fall away from us like that.
Yeah.
It was just so sudden.
Yeah. So would you go to parties with these guys, and did you ever get invited to go do crazy shit?
With the artists?
Were you, was it just, no. You would show up and film all this? Or
yeah.
Did you ever get involved in any of the, you ever even jam with any of these guys? Did you ever get involved in any of that part of it?
No.
Never been into the music, you've never like been a part of the musical.
Well, I used to go see him when I was younger.
I'm just curious if you ever got the, you ever got the urge to just go up there and sing with these guys or anything like that.
Oh, no.
So you were just so focused on your job and everything. That's
absolutely
cool.
Absolutely. It was amazing enough just sitting down with them and capturing their story, Because when I was growing up, going to see the bands here, the local bands, never in a million years did I think that I would be doing this all these years later. And again, when I started doing music videos, these doors would start opening. But then when I came up with this idea and I contacted Jim Quinn, they just flew open. And
did it seem like these guys were really receptive to doing this?
They were.
They really wanted their stories to be told.
They were honored to do it. They said, as a matter of fact, there was one guy back in the 80s or 90s who attempted to do this. But he gave up. He said, this is too much, And I kind of get the point because it's just a monster thing to do. You know, 5 years of work. When I got like a year and a half or 2 years into it, it took 2.5 years just to get the interviews.
Wow.
Yep.
So that's just all the legwork that went
into it. Oh, my God, yeah. And once I got into it so far, I would wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning. What did I get myself into, you know? I'm going to have to really carve something out of what I'm doing. And I couldn't quit. No, I'm going the whole distance with it. And there's still a lot more that can be done with us.
Well, you said you still have a lot of footage.
Oh,
also.
My God. I have all this other interview footage. And I'm going to put out a companion DVD to this. But I got to sit down and take out everything that I put in this one and craft it into this next one, you know. And I'm going to call it Cutting Room Floor because I basically, it's the old film splicing.
These are the ones that didn't make the first cut, actually. Is that what it is? But was like right. You said, it was very hard to do because you had to take a lot of stuff that you would have wanted to keep in just to get it down to 3.5 hours,
It's tough.
Yeah, I do that for the show.
It is.
Sometimes it's tough, but you have to. Because nobody's going to watch an 8-hour anything, right?
You have to. So, that's producing.
It is.
You know, and editing.
It really is.
So,
And you've also done other things, too, not just this. I mean, you've been involved in making commercials. You've been involved. Yeah. You got involved in a whole entire myriad of things.
I did some things for CNN back in the day. I work for Global Broadcasting. Avery Friedman, the civil rights attorney here in Cleveland, very well-known guy. Well, he had a show on CNN called Legal Guys. And we would broadcast from the Palace Theater every Saturday onto CNN. Okay. We'd link up, to the satellite. And my buddy Jim Giganti and I were the crew. We were his crew. And something like this, here's Avery, and we got the cameras, and it's live on CNN. So we did that, and... Yeah, I did a couple commercials for MMS back in the day. I'll send it to you.
I'll play it.
You could punch up. It's a 30-second spot.
America, Beatles, Chicago, Dylan, Elton John, Frampton, Genesis, Hendrix, Iggy Pop, James Gang, King Crimson, Julian Lennon, Moody Blues, Nazareth, Outlaw, Police, Queen, Rolling Stones, Steely Dan, Traffic, Uriah Heep, Van Morrison, Who, XTC, Neil Young, Zeppelin, The Buzzard, A to Z Rock and Roll, and beyond, 100.7 WMMS.
When I first started, getting known a little bit, and this was before the internet, I would wrap up tapes and send them out, like weddings or whatever I was doing. And I'd send him across the country. And I got this phone call from a guy in Las Vegas. And he says, man, it's really hard getting good camera people, and I saw some of your work, and I think we could use you. And I said, in Vegas? He says, yeah, it's booming out here, He says, I'll start you off at $40,000 a year. I said, oh, really? He said, before you know it, you'll be making $60,000, $80,000, $100,000. I says, well, what do you do? He says, well, I do adult films. I said, really? What kind of adult films? And, he kept seeing the money thing, his hook. And I said, you mean porn? And he said, yeah. And I says, well, what do you want me to do? He said, I need a good camera guy. And I says, what's your criteria? And in a nutshell, he said, well, let me ask you this. Can you... film a guy and a woman having sex? And I said, I could probably do that. He said, how about two women and a guy? I said, yeah. He says, how about two women? I says, yeah, I could do that. But then he said, what about two men? I said, no, no, I'm done. I can't. He says, you'll get used to it. You'll get used to it. I said, no, man, I can't turn my hand. I got to go in for the shot. I can't do it. I hung a phone up. I said, sorry, man. I don't care what you pay me. I'm not doing it. True story. Yes.
He went right down the line of like, he wanted to see where the cutoff was.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Well, at least you didn't make it to the animals.
True story. So, anyway, I continued on doing personal. bar mitzvahs, bat mitzvahs, birthday parties for.
Well, you're still every once in a while filming like a live. Aren't you? Haven't I seen you like? There's been gigs that you're actually filming for some of these bands too.
Yeah. The same summer that we started Glass Harp, Eric Carmen called me, tracked me down at my brother's house in Erie, Pennsylvania, and said, "I'm starting a new band called Raspberries. Do you want to join it?" So I said, "No, I'm going to start a band with John." And so it was interesting how all that was going on at the same time. There was Joe Walsh. In fact, Joe used to come on stage, or I'd get on stage with James Gangward. He'd come on stage with Glass Harp. And we used to jam a lot back in those days. Remember those days?
That'll be fine.